mentioned there was a $200 bounty on each of their heads. And almost miraculously, Union troops descended upon the scene and reminded the Confederates that they were standing on Union soil. Then they took Martha Jane and her three children to the shore of the Mississippi River. They found a dilapidated boat with one oar and told her, "Man, you have to take it from here." So she got into the boat. Augusta says his mother never rode a boat in her life. And she took the trek across the Mississippi with Confederates shooting at her, and she made it across it. But made it she did. And that's where the story begins. Father Tolton. And still today, as you can see from the little video here, you know, the farm is still there where the Toltons labor, a farm that is increasingly visited by many tour groups and individuals. That little church building there is the church that Tolton was baptized in, as well as his parents were married in 1859. There are two cemeteries, one on each side of the church. There's one cemetery where the slave owners, the Elliott family and their descendants are buried, other farmers in the region. And on the other side, they have handsome grave owners. On the other side of the church, there's a series of graves of slaves who worked the region there. Those graves have no names on them at all. A group of students from Notre Dame University came recently in the last year to do some soundings in the ground, and they found about 80 graves there. And they put white crosses on them, but we don't know who's all buried there. The area remains pretty pristine, as it was more than 100 years ago. Farmers still farming, no modern roads or signage. Back then, tobacco and vegetable farming were chief in the area. So let me set the context for Saint as we're doing it for Rome, so you can understand where Tolton comes from. And for this, we're gonna have to visit the 19th century of our country. Missouri was a slave-holding state that encouraged slave owners from the South to come to the North because life was more lucrative in the North and there was a lot of trouble in the South. That northeastern section of Missouri was the biggest slave-holding section of the state. And during the time of the Toltons, and according to the 1860 census that we have, there were 3,063 slaves in northeast Missouri and 11,722 whites. Monroe County, the state of Missouri. It was the practice of some Catholic slave owners to have their slaves baptized Catholic. Outside of soothing the conscience of the slave masters to some degree, Catholicism did not necessarily win any tangible benefits for blacks. There seems to have been some acknowledgement by some owners that the slaves had sold. But then there existed the rationalization that they did not have rights to official marriage and family life, evidenced by the cavalier breaking up of spouses, selling off parents from their children and children from their parents. Martha Jane's husband, Peter Paul, must have felt the urgency of all of this, because at that time, Frederick Douglass was trying to urge Abraham Lincoln to let black men fight on the Union side. And Abraham Lincoln was kind of ambivalent about this for the longest until it was allowed, finally. In any event, Peter died, and Martha would find out that her husband was deceased about 7 years later. She found his name on a list of Civil War casualties. And then she applied for pension. We have the pension document, her application, where she received $8 a month till her death in 1911. Augustus, those names are thrown around with some frequency about him. Father Tolton never signed his name completely on any of the letters that have survived. He just signed his name Father A. Tolton, probably in recognition that he was known by a series of names. great-great-grandniece who lives outside of Chicago says he was named after his maternal grandfather, Augustus Chisey. But as was the custom in those days, if a child was presented at the baptismal font with a name that was kind of pagan in origin, the priest routinely would change the name on the spot. It happened to some of us. And so it was easy to reason to Augustine as opposed to Augustus Caesar. So he was baptized Augustine, that's the name that appears on his baptismal certificate. In Rome as a student, he was known as Gus. And he was known as Father Gus in Chicago as a priest. So whatever you wish to call him, Augustine or Augustus or Gus or August, he won't mind. Martha and her husband, Peter Paul, must have plotted their route of escape for a very, very long time. Because as you read the narratives, the slave narratives that are extant today, you'll find that the punishment for running away was rather brutal. People could have a foot cut off, or they could be hung up and whipped half to death and have vinegar or alcohol thrown in their wounds, or salt. Children could be taken away from a woman who ran away. The escape had to be an absolute success. They escaped somewhere between July and September of 1863. Again, Stephen Elliott died in July. The records would indicate that that was the period of time frame in which they were running. Finally, bringing her children to the town of Quincy near the Mississippi River, a station of the Underground Railroad, after this harrowing escape, she finally settles down and tries to educate her children. So the backdrop of Augustus's life, his boyhood and his youth, was a very troubled period in our history. Civil War and the tumultuous period of Reconstruction following the war that entailed the nation's ambivalence regarding the plight of freed slaves. According to the history books, the Civil War, of course, officially ended in 1865 with the surrender of General Robert E. Lee and his Confederate Army. But on the streets, another fierce battle was just beginning. America was supposed to be reuniting and healing its wounds and moving past years of civil unrest. However, a close look into that period reveals a sinister snapshot of discontent and southern anger, a scarred nation caught in the midst of political riots and angry insurgencies while the South was counting its losses. The murder, the terrorism, and chaos that took place during Reconstruction signaled an uncertain future for this country. Supreme Court Justice Roger Taney had already stoked the fires of racial hatred by writing in 1857 that blacks had no rights which the white man was bound to respect. And while the government struggled to gain control, the persecution of free blacks continued in the former Confederate states. Terrorist groups such as the Ku Klux Klan, made up of Confederate veterans, emerged in 1866 in the state of Tennessee. The Ku Klux Klan, as you know, exercised their free speech often in the forms of violence, intimidation, and murder. The main targets were articulate and politically active blacks, white people who helped them, and institutions who had the aim to aid blacks and Jews and Catholics. Membership in the Ku Klux Klan included local law enforcement persons, ministers, lawyers, merchants, and otherwise law-abiding, church-going citizens. While the North seemed to be spared some of the violence, left untreated was the general plight of blacks in society, the rights to suffrage and education and economic improvement. These met with fierce resistance, especially in the South, but also in some places in the North. The social separation blacks and whites became the norm nationwide. racial inequality was indeed a social praxis, and much of this was taken for granted by the Christian churches. The race issue split the churches. Ministers and congregations were divided over the question. The three largest Protestant groups, Baptists, Presbyterians, and Methodists, formally split up their denominations over the question. The Presbyterians were first to split in 1837, followed by the Baptists in 1844. In the Methodist Church, a lengthy debate over the right of a slaveholder to serve in the rank as bishop triggered the formation of the breakaway Methodist Episcopal Church in 1846. While it proved a murky discussion whether black men could serve as ministers in these denominations, and whether black people could worship alongside whites in these denominations, the blacks soon got the message and were forming their own churches with their own indigenous ministers. Free churches, as they came to be called, mimicking in respects the contours of the established denominations, or what came to be known as the traditional black church experience, formed and shaped and led by the saga of the black experience. In the Catholic Church, clergy were preoccupied by the needs of the various immigrant groups settling in America who spoke no English, where social intolerance, even among these groups here and there, erupted in acts of violence between and among groups. Bishops and religious communities of men and women owned slaves, while individual priests were seen baptizing blacks, these same blacks could not worship alongside whites in the churches, but were confined to choir lofts and roped off sections in the rear. My grandmother used to speak of this while she lived in Long Island, New York. They seldom went to communion in those days because the Eucharist wasn't brought to them. Neither were they allowed to kneel in the communion rail with a white person. The baptismal entries of slaves often would not mention their parentage, but only the owner's names. This exists on Augustus Tolton's baptismal certificate. His mother and father not mentioned. It mentions that he was the black slave child who was owned by Stephen Elliott, and his sponsor was Stephen Elliott's wife, Sibylla. Weddings of slaves were performed by priests who would not register these marriages in the church's books, because officially the marriages of slaves were not given public recognition. The social norm of separate space for whites and blacks meant that blacks were generally not received into our schools, our convents, or our seminaries, for fear the church would lose what little prestige it had in a Protestant milieu and be charged with defying the prevailing social mood of the time, namely that whites and blacks do not mix, and that for reasons written in nature, not ordained by the Creator, whites were superior and blacks inferior. Absent from the program of the Catholic Church was a corporate strategy for the evangelization of the freed slave. Several popes encouraged the American bishops to do something for freed slaves. Here and there, heroic individual priests and religious ministered unto blacks, but the Catholic Church was not prepared to deal with the race issue in face of the anti-Catholic prejudice that was prevalent in the country at the time. And trying to manage the disturbance of the internal morale of the church at that time, certain internal needs of a burgeoning non-English-speaking immigrant church. And to this day, we suffer for lack of an earlier program of attention paid to the black community. For the vast majority of Southerners, slavery was not a sin. Certain slave owners provided their slaves with Christian instruction, some of them justifying the system by passages found in the Bible. Abolitionists and other conscience-troubled Christians were fearful of this militant defense of slavery that perdured long after emancipation. But as we as east and west sections of the country grew closer to things like the railroads, the telegraph, and newsprint, the South was aggressively seeking to expand slavery into new territories and states where it had been outlawed for decades. And as the history books explain, slavery was profitable, a way of life for the South and vital to the economy of the time. Southerners were unwilling to have further changes to their traditions imposed on them by the victorious North. They did not want to see former slaves whom they considered social inferiors as political equals. They also needed blacks to remain a dependent workforce in order to grow the cash crops on which the South depended upon: cotton, tobacco, sugar, cash crops, rice, and other commodities. For many a Southerner, Reconstruction was an annoyance, a period of political uncertainty, poverty, and fearsome social reform. Although they had lost the war, Southerners attempted to maintain traditions of control, using desperate means to redeem the South from Northern domination. And added to this was the European immigration arriving in places north. Urban crowding in cities that brought with it a scarcity of jobs, increased pressures stoking fear, resulting intermittently in riots and mob actions from New England to the Midwest. Slaves and former slaves were allowed only a haphazard participation in American life in the 19th century, and there were no laws that would guarantee their movement in society, let alone protect them. Unfortunately, much of this apartheid was co-opted by the churches. Following their escape from slavery, Martha Jane and Augustus worked several jobs in Quincy to support the family. At a tobacco factory, a bottling and a beverage factory, and a factory that made saddles for horses. Augustus attended several schools in between, seasonal workshops. He was dismissed from one Catholic school, St. Boniface. The church still exists in Quincy today. Bishop Rebarkin wants to put his relics there. Due to protests and threats from white parishioners. But the Irish Father Peter McGurr, a sympathetic pastor of St. Peter Parish in Quincy, assured him of safety in his parish school. Daring his parishioners to object, Father McGurr enrolled Augustus in St. Peter School. The parish, as you saw in the picture there, names its parish hall after Augustus and has this big marble monument there erected in his likeness. At St. Peter's, several priests and sisters took young Tolton under their wing and tutored him in the catechism in the languages of German and Italian and Latin and other subjects that would keep him on par academically. From the time Augustus made his first communion and confirmation in 1870, he began to speak about an attraction to the priesthood. But the obstacles to his entrance in the seminary seemed insurmountable. The priests who mentored him saw signs of a religious vocation in Tolton. The young man had already worked as a catechist for the neighborhood's Negro children, serving Mass daily, helping around the church, cleaning and preparing the sacristy, and otherwise showing himself to be a devout young man. The Franciscan fathers offered Augustus a scholarship to Quincy College. In the meantime, today it's Quincy University, where he studied philosophy and the liberal arts. But after almost 7 years of writing and inquiry in various seminaries around the country, it was learned that U.S. seminaries would not accept a black student. Sadly, some church institutions did not see it possible to take risks with their reputations by breaking through racial inequality with a counter witness. So the Franciscan fathers appealed to their superior general in Rome, who had contact with the prefect of the Propaganda Fide. Again, after an agonizing wait, following a back and forth of correspondence, we have these letters that we got from the Vatican archives. Interesting letters. Tolton finally received news that he was accepted to study at the Urbanum in Rome. And as has mentioned, it was thought that he would be sent to Africa because his ministry here could not be successful in a country submerged in apartheid. The propaganda Fide, as you know, has for centuries prepared priests to labor in faraway mission countries, where in most instances the church, at least at that time, was working in primary evangelization. Keep in mind, in the 19th century, the United States was considered mission territory. We were not yet considered to be an established church in our own yet. It was thought that the social climate in the States would thwart Tolton's work as a priest. He was there from 1880 to 1886. The day before he was ordained a priest, the assignments for all of the deacons about to be ordained priesthood were all read off. And Giovanni Siglioni, the cardinal prefect of the propaganda, called Tolton over, and he said this, and I quote, "The United States of America considers itself the most enlightened nation on the face of the earth. If that be true, they should be able to accept a black priest. So I changed my mind. I'm going to send you back home." The Vatican had faith that grace would run out in the United States. Augustus was taken aback by the news, because up to this time he was preparing himself with African dialects, and you can get the map of Africa and so forth. He was prepared to go. So dutifully, under the inspiration of his propaganda oath, he went back to the Diocese of Alton, A-L-T-O-N, Diocese of Alton in Illinois, today at Springfield. He received partial acceptance in his hometown, Quincy, but turmoil soon erupted. Prejudiced opposition mounted against him from both Protestant and Catholic clergymen, and one German priest in particular, a man by the name of Father Michael Weiss. He thought Tolton should restrict himself to ministering to blacks. As it was, whites were sneaking out of their churches on Sunday and going down to St. Joseph's Church, where Tolton was a pastor, to hear his sermons, receive his ministrations, and contribute financially to this poor parish. This upset fellow clergy. Father Weiss took his objections to the bishop any number of times, and he was called into the office and reprimanded. He was accused of disturbing the Protestants, who looked at him askance for perpetuating Romanism. And he was accused by Catholic clergymen of creating an unacceptable situation of mixing the races. Being black and Catholic, Tolton lost on both counts. Folks could not quite put the two together in those days. There were no protocols for being a black priest called to serve everyone. With every step he took, he was violating some written or unwritten rule. And in due time, in the midst of the storm, sympathetic white people began disengaging from his parish. So as opposition mounted, Tolton began to realize that he would be asked to leave Quincy, where he had begun a credible ministry to the Negro community, where black Catholics were accustomed to the gift of a priest to look like them. The straw that broke the camel's back was this. There was a young socialite woman in town who was getting married. But the man she chose as her husband was unacceptable to her mother. So her mother went around Quincy visiting all of the Catholic priests and ordering them not to celebrate the wedding of her daughter. But she forgot Tolton. She arranged with Father Tolton to have her wedding. And with all the due permissions and delegations, according to the law at that time, we didn't have a canon law, code at that time, but he had all the right permissions. He celebrated the wedding, and all hell broke loose. Tolton had to get out of town. And in the midst of all this, Archbishop Patrick Freeman issued his invitation, said, "Come to Chicago members of African Americans here who could use your service. Tolton hesitated giving an example, giving a response at first, until he had checked in with Rome. And he finally accepted the Archbishop's invitation and went to Chicago in December 1889, the week before Christmas. This was 3 years after he was ordained. So he was only in Quincy 3 years as a priest. Keep in mind, friends, that particular period in our nation's social history, Tolton grew up in a time where it was forbidden for a black man to look a white man into the face when he was spoken to, or when he was addressing a white man. He always had to look down. When I was a boy, I never understood this. My parents would always tell me, whenever you talk to anyone, look at them straight in the face. I never knew what that meant until much later on, what they were saying and why they were saying it. It was a time where a train ride meant that usually there was only one car for blacks. And if there wasn't enough seats, then you had to stand until the seat was freed up by someone getting off the train. There were public restrooms and eating establishments and rooming houses were off limits to us. Laws, written and unwritten, humiliations of one sort or another, perpetuated the inferior status of black people without recourse, appeal, or objection. And Tolton would not live to see the overturn of all of this some 75 years down the line, with the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and the Voting Rights Act of 1965. Taking a fledgling congregation of Negro Catholics titled the St. Augustine Society that gathered in St. Mary Church downtown Chicago, Father Tolton became the founding pastor of the new Negro apostolate, St. Monica Church, 36th and Dearborn Street. The well-educated Father Tolton proved a wise priest, but his priesthood was hampered by isolation, economic hardship, and self-doubt. We have letters he wrote to Mother Catherine Drexel, which portray his pathos in that socially intolerant era. He was dedicated to the people and faithfully visited the sick, who came to the rescue of the desperate poor in Chicago's South Side's tenement and substandard neighborhoods. He was offered a number of speaking engagements in church circles in the East by Cardinal Gibbons, addressing black and white assemblies of Catholics in Boston, Philadelphia, Galveston, Washington, D.C., and other places. He was invited to offer high mass and address the first two, if not three, colored Catholic Congresses, today known as the Black Catholic Congress. There he expounded upon the aspirations of the black race and called upon the church to assist the improvement of a neglected race. But the drumbeat of inequality was reinforced in 1896 with the Supreme Court's decision, Plessy versus Ferguson, and a vote of 7-1. Which endorsed as lawful the various state laws ordering racial separation under the social doctrine of separate but equal. And this court's decision gave legitimacy to many practices our parents and grandparents grew up with. The separate washrooms, separate entrances to buildings, separate drinking fountains, restaurant and public transportation facilities, separate schools, that aided and abetted a culture of discrimination and unfair treatment. This is the world of Father Tolton, the world in which he lived and the world in which he died. His health began to show signs of exhaustion and distress. Following 8 years of pastoral labor in Chicago, trying to build a church for his congregation, a church that would symbolize that black Catholics had a place in the church, he died at the age of 43. Result of complications associated with a heat stroke during an exceptional heat wave that hit the city the first week of July, 1897. The daily newspapers reported more than 60 people, including two priests, died that week of unabated heat. In gathering together his archives, archival records, we have no information that speaks of his health condition. Blacks seldom had access to adequate health care beyond some old-fashioned folk remedies. Few, if any, reputable hospitals would take us as patients where whites were served. Tolton could very well have been exposed to the common ailments of the day, untreated hypertension, perhaps even tuberculosis. But his parishioners were aware that he was wearing himself out. Hard work that included mental stress connected with fundraising to support his parish and maneuvering the choppy waters of racial acceptance. At times he had to ask the altar boy to bring over a chair for him to sit in to deliver his sermon. In the 19th century, before antibiotics were available, priests oftentimes died before they were 50 because they were often exposed to people with a variety of communicable diseases. And we have no information that told ever saw a doctor. So getting off the train at the 35th Street station, he collapsed on the street and was rushed to Mercy Hospital, run by the Mercy Lines. The constables asked the sisters if they would accept him, and they did. He died 8:30 that evening, and was buried by his specific request in Quincy at St. Peter's Center. Saints are men and women who took the gospel and took it to themselves with real seriousness. They lived it within the circumstances of their times, and for each of the saints, the circumstances were different. Some of them were butchered for their faith in Christ and their loyalty to the church. Tolton was beset on all sides by racism and its tragic consequences. As I mentioned in the video, there, in that period of the dark pages of our country, no one emerges as a saint. If this cause is successful, he would be the first who arises out of that historical period of race discrimination. We have no one like that so far. There obviously were many civic martyrs in that period, white as well as black. People were killed, murdered, executed, all kinds of stuff. But through it all, he was a welcome pastor for all. He was creating a situation that the society of our time simply could not find conscionable. Unbeknownst to Cardinal Simeone, he was launching the church's apostolate to whites by sending him back home, even though he would walk ultimately through a gauntlet of suffering and lack of appreciation for who he was and what he was. But he believed that no door could be closed against the movement of the Spirit. We are a country that immigrants consider a land of opportunity, Simeone said, enlightened. This opportunity and freedom has come in part by the shedding of blood, loss of life, a lot of grief. Many of these stories run orally in the tradition in the African-American community. We bishops were in Baltimore for the rededication of the Basilica there back in 2000. And as we bishops were processing into the churches, beautiful, gorgeous churches we've done for the millennium, the bishop leaned over to me. He said, "Bishop Perry, I want you to watch the lay people walk into this basilica." This was the auxiliary bishop of Baltimore. "Watch their eyes. And watch the people come into the basilica, and you see people looking at the blue accents and gold leaf, the new pews, and all of that. When the blacks walked into the church, they immediately looked up to see if they retained the choir loft. We were obliged to sit. They retained it." That's what, where Mother Mary Lang sat with her sisters. She's the foundress of the sisters there in Baltimore. Precious pieces of history mixed with a lot of pain and suffering, but a lot of joy. Father Tolton gives us joy. A touching story, and we trust that you find his life inspirational and touching as well. Thank you for listening.
Bishop Perry will take a few questions if you have any for him. That we know. That's on record. And approved.
but for some reason or another, they did not record their marriages. Probably because it was the social practice not to do that. You take Augustus, Father James Healy, the Black Bishop of Portland, Maine. The family did not identify with the Black community, but his father was an Irishman, Michael Healy, who was a successful businessman. And the woman he took was a slave woman, but he never married her. He educated all of his children in Europe, and they moved to the majority of society, but they never married because it was a common law marriage. The three of his sons became priests, one of them went to Georgetown University. Three of his daughters became nuns. He couldn't get the church to give him a marriage certificate. And the contradictions. Yes?
Have there been any miracles that we can say Father Tolton was responsible for? And if so, what time?
We're looking into three right now. One involves a woman, an 80-year-old woman, whose foot was going to be cut off. She was diabetic, and her foot went gangrene. And suddenly, no longer gangrene, it's healed. Another one involves a man who was bit by a spider in his garden, and his arm began deteriorating. He became practically leprous. His flesh was just falling off. And before and after, now the arm is completely healed, like nothing happened. And the other involves a seminarian who collapsed while lifting weights in the gym. And he was pronounced dead. And somehow came back to life. But everybody was praying to Tolton in all these three cases. But we cannot pronounce them as miracles yet because Rome hasn't said we can yet. We don't have a miracle until Rome says you have a miracle. Tell them it's wondrous. But I believe we have established the connection, the required connection. Tolton, like all saints, they have to be more than just a historical figure, someone, a celebrity, or whatever. Rome wants you to establish a connection between heaven and earth with the individual candidate in between. And for the longest time, Rome has required that to be manifested realm of the miracle. Except if you're a martyr, martyring only a miracle. And any and everybody else needs a miracle for the application. Additional one for sanctity. Yes.
What was the period of time after Augustus passed away that another African American priest came to that diocese? Was there a long period of time? I'm sure.
Yes, there was. It would have been Father Rollins Lambert in about 1959. He was a convert in Episcopalianism.
Yeah. Is Tolton close to being declared venerable?
Yeah. Roman authorities will come visit us in February to close off the investigative phase. I believe we have amassed everything that there is by document, written record, correspondence, witness testimony, and so forth. It's a big, huge, thick thing. And they will come to inspect all of that to see if it satisfies their requirements. And if so, that is delivered to Rome, and then they create what is called a positio. A positio is a bound, depending upon the stretch of the person's life. Foot Machine had three volumes with his, but Tolton, I think, would fit his into two, maybe one and a half. In the book form, it summates all of that, and then it's given to the Holy Father, and he studies it. And if he believes, and if he's ready to pronounce this person lived a heroic, virtuous life, then the person is pronounced venerable. Yes, he's close. We would like to open up his grave next spring or next fall. Because we need rocks.
Just mention about his preaching. Are there any documents of his preaching?
Tolton was an extemporaneous preacher. He spoke off the cuff. We have snippets of talks that he had, but he did not write. Of course, there was no typewriter in those days. We have nothing that he left us in writing. We also have reason to believe, for a while there, Tolton was afraid to leave anything behind in writing, because he feared being assaulted by the establishment. He feared the Ku Klux Klan, you know that for a fact. So he didn't leave much behind outside of his written letters to Catherine Drexel, a priest by the name of Father Joseph Slattery, bishops that he wrote around the country and in Rome. That's about it. Yes?
These prayers to him for the Spider Bites or the Snake Bites or whatever, was that before or after he died?
Well, this is just recent. It's recent, just within the. Since we established the cause, as you see in that prayer card, we ask anyone who wished to give testimony regarding any favors received to write the cardinal. We get those frequently. We have at least 40 some of them so far from people.
A saint of healing?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. She never learned to read or write, Tolton spoke of her. But she was his housekeeper and sacristan, and she sang in the parish choir. She died in 1911. She's buried in Chicago with her daughter in one of the Catholic cemeteries there. But she seems to have been a woman who receded and led a quiet life. We have a series of census records in the city that show where she lived up until her death. We have her pension records and all of that as well. Unfortunately, we don't have a picture of her. Hold on.
Because she wasn't like a real big supporter. I mean,
when she was in public. In public, yeah. No, not in that sense.
But in the background.
In the background. She comes from, obviously, being a slave. She came from a very, very humble background. Tolton's memory has always been there. We've always known that he existed. I remember as a seminarian, we knew of Father Tolton. I didn't know that much about him. And the few black priests that there are, he was always listed. He was always listed. That much we knew. His grave has always been a site of visitation, in that sense. So that much has always existed as far as a continuum. He's been held in precious memory. Yes, that's true. Yes.
I am concerned about the lack of vocations coming from the black community, black Catholic community in this area. And I wondered, how long are you in town?
Want me to rustle up some vocations for you?
Well, I can remember when I was in school that Bishop Bowers came to school, and it was so impressive. We didn't get any priests out of that class, but it was just a pleasant, very pleasant experience coming, you know, seeing a black priest a bishop, coming to see you in your classroom, it was awesome. And so that's the reason for my question, how I'm in your town.
You're going to have to get back tomorrow night. I'm teaching money line. My seminarians will agree to get money on that. Yes.
I'd like to comment on the new Pope. I have fresh ideas.
You have fresh ideas.
Good ideas. Mm-hmm. I mean, I can see that the faith I've seen, that he came in as a person with compassion. Mm-hmm. More compassion than I've seen in the earth. He showed more love. He put more emphasis on the love, more so on the life.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of things that I've seen human beings out of Europe, European folk. He's got different ideas. He's been around poor people.
Mm-hmm.
He's walked among them. I'm scared for him. Because there's some people out there will take it out.
Mm-hmm.
Because they don't have the ideas that he has. See, sometimes we have old ideas of someone, and they'll never grow because they follow behind someone and they keep up the same thoughts and ideas. If you understand what I mean.
We're going to pray for you.
That's
Knights of Columbus, Knights of Great Plato, always have their swords ready to go.
That's right.
This is a very loose time.
Yes,
in other words, we have to pray for them. Kept safe.
Pray for him every day. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Yes, one of them.
What would you say are the three sort of greatest virtues of Father Tolton? What is most heroic about him that young people today, that you would offer to young people today?
Well, I think his sense of perseverance in the face of being told no more often than yes in his life. His courage through consistent disappointment is really a model for us handling all our disappointments. You know, we all have them. He's a symbol of that. His cheerfulness and his pastoral extension to people, even despite all of that, is a great model for priesthood. So his long suffering and his perseverance, his charity, I think those are the big three. Obviously, his loyalty and his sense of obedience as a priest follow up on that. These are the virtues that the Theological Commission will be expounding on when they present their final report in February. Yes,
a question about, I guess it kind of intrigues me. Why did they keep their Catholic faith? Here they were baptized Catholic. I presume they're not going to have a whole lot of catechesis in the faith.
That is a mystery question. I think much of it has to do with the individual Catholic priest and sisters who minister to them. The Tolton, it was largely the Notre Dame sisters who taught him to speak German fluently. And the Irish priests in Quincy who really took him under their wing and tutored him and prepared him to come with me, though several of them were writing seminaries. That kind of ministry and pastoral care is impressive. It always has been impressive to African Americans. And we accept anybody to be our pastor. We're not partial in that sense. All you have to be is a kind priest. You don't expect much, but if you're kind, and if you're loving, accept you with open arms. And I think that took the Tolton's experience than any African American community. Yes.
Tell me a little bit more about the church in Chicago. I think I remember reading somewhere that everything that Father Tolton did was in the basement of the church, and also that he had lived in a basement where it was damp. Is this true?
Yeah, he was never able to finish building St. Monica's. Catherine Drexel gave him about $36,000 towards building the church. Then a woman named Ann McNeil gave $10,000. I think the diocese gave, matched that with another $10,000. But by the time he died, they had not finished anything more than the first floor. You might remember seeing a picture of the unfinished church. They put a roof on it. That, and the blacks worshipped in that for quite a long time, but then it was raised in 1945 to make room for a housing project. And the parish was merged with nearby St. Elizabeth's Church that was pastored by the Divine Word Missionary Fathers. So they have, to this day, the legacy of the St. Monica and Tolton.
On behalf of Father Benedicto Pinsola, our rector, I want to thank Bishop Perry for an outstanding talk, concluding the Athenaeum's Year of Faith activities. We have a wonderful model of Father Augustus Tolton. Bishop Perry, we want to acknowledge your presence among us and to thank you very much. Thank you. To conclude this evening's event, that we might together pray the prayer for the canonization of Father Tolton, found on this card.
We'll pause just briefly for the middle of the prayer to mention your request. Let's stand. O God, we give you thanks for your servant and priest, Father Augustus Tolton, who labored among us in times of contradiction, times that were both beautiful and paradoxical. His ministry helped lay the foundation for a truly Catholic gathering in faith in our time. We stand in the shadow of his ministry. May his life continue to inspire us and enable us to have confidence and hope that will forge a new evangelization for the Church of God. Father in heaven, Father Tolton's suffering service sheds light upon our sorrows. We see them through the prism of every son's passion and death. If it be your will, O God, glorify your servant, Father Tolton. I grant him the favor I now request through his intercession. So that all may know the goodness of this priest, whose memory brings far to the church he loved. Complete what you have begun in us, that we might work for the fulfillment of your kingdom, not to us the glory, but the glory to you, O God, through Jesus Christ, your Son, and our Lord, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. You are our God, living and reigning forever and ever. There's a definitive biography on Father Tolton called From Slave to Priest. It's published by Ignatius Press. It was first came out in 1973. It used to be Franciscan Herald Press, but Ignatius Press now has the rights to it. And then lastly, we have a webpage where you can follow the progress of the cause if you're interested in the story of Tolton. All you have to do is type in toltoncanonization.org and it will come right up. There's a lot of interesting historical tidbits and pieces of recent research into his life and so forth you will find interesting. Thank you. Thank you.